I think it's difficult to deny that Sega have had a pretty spotty track record. Even ignoring the more infamous flops like Aliens, Colonial Marines, and the latest Sonic Boom game, the quality of Sega's releases has been pretty erratic. The CEO of Sega Games, Haruki Satomi, even apologised in a recent interview for the lack of consistency, acknowledging that they have lost the fans' trust. Which, you know, doesn't fix the problem, but it's still a really admirable thing to do, in my opinion. Anyway, I think that he is absolutely right about Sega having lost the fans' trust. A number of people, fans and otherwise, have become understandably distrustful of Sega's output. And this distrust seems to have taken on a life of its own. People are becoming distrustful of Sega's old games as well. Games that were previously accepted to be good or even great are now being reassessed. Channels like The Game Grumps and Pro Jared have ripped the pish right out of the Sonic Adventure titles, for example. In fact, I have seen more than one person claim that even the Mega Drive Sonic games were bad. So with all of this said, I think the question has to be asked, were Sega ever really any good? Well, I'd like to answer that question with another question. Why does nobody talk about Nights into Dreams anymore? Nights, developed by Sonic Team, was released in 1996 for the Sega Saturn. It fought an uphill battle from the word go. The game was faced with three challenges. One, it was released in the Saturn, which wasn't selling so well. Two, it was in direct competition with the launch of the Nintendo 64. And three, ipso facto, it was in direct competition with the launch of Mario 64. That's a pretty unfortunate position to be in, if we're being honest. And I think that history can tell you how that went. Super Mario 64 pioneered and perfected a new way to play games, and Nights kind of fell into obscurity. But I didn't know any of that back in 1996. I was 3 years old and still grappling with the complexities of not soiling myself. So the first opportunity I had to play Nights was in 2012, when it was re-released on XBLA, PSN, and Steam. And honestly, I did not enjoy it. Nights' biggest shortcoming is its complete lack of conveyance. Even if you read the instructions, its rules and parameters are poorly defined, and my first experiences with the game were negative as a result. Now, I'm not going to insult your intelligence. Implicit in that statement is the idea that I enjoy Nights now, which I do. But I think that it would be worthwhile to discuss why I had such a difficult time with the game at the beginning. Let's start with a breakdown of the game's structure. The game begins with the player taking control of a child as they run around a 3D space. Almost immediately, they're mugged by a menagerie of bizarre creatures who steal their orbs and place them in these capsules. The player is bombarded with information as soon as they begin playing, but it's difficult to parse this information without having read the background material. The story itself is easy enough to get. These bad guys have taken your stuff and you want to get it back. But its relevance to the gameplay is more nebulous. Would you know, for example, that you have to collect 20 of these chips in order to open the capsule? And furthermore, would you know that you have to adopt an entirely different perspective and control scheme in order to get them? This is where Nights comes in. Touching Nights lets the player begin playing as them. At this point, the perspective and the controls completely change. The game adopts a 2D perspective, a timer begins, and Nights starts flying on a preset loop around the stage. The goal here is to collect 20 chips and crash into the Idea Capture in order to destroy it. Once the Idea Capture is destroyed, bonus time begins, where the points are doubled. This lasts until the player touches the Idea Palace at the end of the lap, where they're graded on their performance and then punted onto the next loop. This process repeats itself three more times, and then Nights is taken to a boss level. Beating the boss more quickly results in a better point multiplier at the end. Can you see why I didn't like this at first? The game fails to communicate its rules and parameters to the player. In total, a level is made up of three separate sections and two separate control schemes. This setup is more complicated than your average game, where the goal is to reach the end of the level with a single control scheme. Both are completely valid approaches, of course, but NiGHTS' rules aren't communicated clearly. There's no tutorial, and the game is so surreal and vibrant that there aren't many visual references to help the player understand what the objects do. For example, if the chips were keys and the Idea Palace had a padlock, it would look a lot worse, but I might be able to understand it better. The poor conveyance is compounded by the controls and perspective when flying. The controls are very sensitive. NiGHTS will respond to even the slightest unintentional nudge on the analog stick. Furthermore, the camera is very close to NiGHTS. Putting these both together then, it's very easy for the player to be blindsided by an obstacle that they had no hope of anticipating and little hope of dodging thanks to the sensitive controls. It results in NiGHTS being somewhat difficult to get the hang of and disrupts the pace of the game significantly. And speaking of disruptions, if the player runs out of time, they drop all of their chips and have to return to the end of the loop as the child. Another pace breaker in a game already full of them. Finally, NiGHTS is an incredibly short game. It has only 7 levels, and it took me only a couple of hours to beat on my first go. And that was it for me. I enjoyed how the game looked and sounded, but all of these problems really put me off NiGHTS. I didn't understand the level designs, and the game wasn't really helping me to. I found controlling NiGHTS really awkward, and it was so short that I felt I didn't really have the time to get to grips with any of it. I put the game down as a flashy, style over substance affair that was indicative of a lot of Sega's output. For me, Mario deserved to win that round. Justice served, and case closed. Now, before you go saying anything about that conclusion, yes, I agree, I was doing NiGHTS a tremendous injustice. Earlier this year, I was watching some gameplay footage online and decided that I would give the game another go. Like I say, I loved its style, and I so badly wanted to like it as a result. Happily, I did like it this time around. The game really clicked into place once I made a simple discovery. I was playing it incorrectly. You see, the structure of the game is actually slightly different to the one that I described. Once the player enters bonus time, so long as they have time left on the clock, they can simply skip the Idea Palace and keep doing laps. As your points are doubled in bonus time, what this means is that you want to spend as little time as possible destroying the Idea Capture before spending as much time as possible doing laps. In essence, the time limit isn't there to get you to the goal as quickly as possible, the time limit is there to get you to score as many points as quickly as possible. As I replayed the laps, I began to notice that I was collecting chips more efficiently and wasn't getting blindsided by obstacles anymore. I began to perform paraloops to draw extra items in. I began to chain actions together, racking up more points in the process. I began to get the laps down in just a few seconds. It is wholly satisfying gracefully ducking in and out of obstacles, threading the needle through giant rings, and paralooping around a big bunch of items for mad points. It is constant, jubilant exhilaration. The colourful graphics and joyful tunes, combined with the tension of seeing if you can whiz around just one last lap, really see this game go from 0 to 60 in an instant. When the game clicks, it's addictive, arcadey, and really, really exciting. There was a really vivid moment where, after getting my first A rank, I realised that joy was pumping around my veins, rather than the usual mix of adipose and ennui. This is why I made such a big deal out of the poor conveyance. It very nearly cost me a game that I absolutely love now. All of the shortcomings I described can be seen as strengths once you understand the game's rules. For example, NiGHTS' sensitivity becomes responsiveness once you're used to it. They're almost one-to-one with the analog stick. The close camera allows NiGHTS to provide constant visual feedback to the player. Any adjustment to NiGHTS' trajectory is instantly visible on the character model. There's a large joint around their waist. NiGHTS' torso will change to show where the player is pointing, while their legs will trail behind them to show where the player has come from. While giving the player constant visual feedback, this also adds a lot of fluidity to NiGHTS' movement. Of course, this design choice does come with the downside that the camera is too close to see what's coming a lot of the time. But as the player is replaying the laps, they begin to anticipate the obstacles. It's like doing laps in a racing game. Even if it's a new track, you can begin to learn it during your first playthrough. Now, of course, that's not to say that you won't mess up. but running out of time results in time taken away from the exhilaration of flying. If the game had simply taken a life off of the player, it wouldn't have stung nearly this much, as you would be back to flying around within seconds. The game encourages its players to master it. To that end, emphasis was placed on replaying the game. An enormous amount of effort went into making the world and the characters appealing. Now, I think that the importance of appealing characters and an appealing world is often understated. But as I said, I wanted this game to be good because of those very things. NiGHTS and the Dream World are the reasons that I returned to the game in the first place. They're the reasons that I am making this video. NiGHTS themselves combines the serenity of an angel with the fun-loving nature of a jester. They tap into what I think is a very primordial and universal appeal, the one of flying when in a dream, which is a fun and serene experience. Combined with NiGHTS's graceful movement, I think the appeal is apparent, and hopefully the player should want to replay the game to get to spend more time with this character, to experience the thrill of flying again. Similarly, each level is unique and detailed. They're all very, well, dreamlike, which is a good aesthetic for a game about dreams, I think. Spring Valley has windmills floating in the background, Mystic Forest is disorienting, and the geography of Soft Museum is springy and pliable. I think the detail serves a real purpose in these levels. It makes them distinct from one another and helps player retention. There's little chance of mixing two levels up, and honestly, each lap takes you on such a different route that I find it difficult to mix even two laps up. All of this is to the end of encouraging the player to explore. By making the worlds detailed, the player is more inclined to want to spend more time in them, and explore to see more of them. The unique geography of every stage gives the impression that you'll find something new if you experiment a little. And you will, the game doesn't disappoint that expectation. And of course, exploration is a great way to incentivize a player to replay a level. The levels even encourage replays by adapting to your performance. If you kill Nightopians and play poorly, the mood becomes more dismal. If you hatch Nightopians and play well, the level becomes more cheerful, and the Nightopians will be more plentiful and happier in the backgrounds. I won't be able to show you any of that in this footage, as I have great big ham hands, but I can give you a music comparison. Here's how the first level sounds on your first playthrough. It becomes more buoyant once you begin breeding and hatching Nightopians. Your choices have a real impact on your environment, and what's more, the choice isn't plonked bluntly in front of you. It's an integrated, holistic part of the experience. Naoto Oshima is quoted as saying, "We wanted a game that didn't feel like a doll being controlled, but to give life to a world stuck inside the television." And I really think that that effort paid off. And, well, to reach the point with all of this, this is why the game only has 7 levels. Each of those levels is designed to be played again and again. There are tons of secrets and tricks that you won't get on your first run through, and even once you know them all, it's butt-clenching excitement when you try to collect them all in one seamless run. NiGHTS is the kind of game that you're going to replay multiple times. You're not going to discover everything on your first playthrough. And doesn't that sound familiar? This is the thing with Sega. Whereas they might look like style over substance, I would instead argue that Sega's games, at their best, are style supplementing substance. More precisely, you have to master the substance to get the style. You can't make full use of Sonic Speed the first time that you play, for example. You have to learn the intricacies of the physics and the level designs. You can't immediately master Gunstar Heroes. You have to learn which control scheme works best with which weapon. You can't just fly NiGHTS around like a madman on your first go. You have to learn where the items and the enemies are, and how to swiftly and accurately maneuver through them. For me, this approach creates a more intimate connection between the player and the game. The player has to drink in the level design in order to master it. By playing these environments over and over, navigating them a little better each time, they become familiar, and hopefully the player should become fond of them. Because these levels are detailed and memorable, and because their design is complex and multifaceted, and most importantly because the player forms an understanding of them, they begin to feel more like worlds. Now, that's all well and good, but seven levels is still seven levels. This approach does mean that Sega games, at their best, are still often pretty short, and it also means that the games might not click with everybody. I mean, I've spent ages waxing lyrical about the classic Sonic games over in Sonic Spitball, but truth be told, I didn't really get them until after a couple of playthroughs. And of course, none of this is to say that other companies lack complexity. But to compare with Mario, for example, I don't really have the same enthusiasm for the levels in the 2D Mario games. You can just plow through a level and you never have to think about it again. In the 3D games, though, this isn't the case, as you have to revisit most levels multiple times. It's why I think that Sunshine is my favourite 3D Mario, despite it doing everything in its power to make me despise it. There are more shines per level, and a very consistent tropical theme. While this means that there are less levels and less variety overall, it also means that I form a deeper understanding of those levels and the world that they take place in. I think that's a quality that Sega mastered very early on. I think that's a quality that Nintendo still struggle with to this day. So, to answer the question that started this video, were Sega ever really any good? I would have to answer absolutely. Sega's background was in arcade games. In fact, the major selling point of the Mega Drive pre-Sonic was its ability to faithfully recreate arcade games. I am generalising a bit here, but in my experience, arcade games are shorter and promote mastery in order to get their player to keep pumping money into them for just one more try. And the mentality that informed these arcade games also informed Sega's console development. The reason I think people are suspicious of that nowadays is that they grew up with other systems, and thus never got to grips with these games' mechanics when they were younger. Kids, generally speaking, have more time for games, but less money to spend on games. So they're forced to play what they have, often to the exclusion of a lot of other stuff. For the Sega kids, this meant that they slowly unlocked the nuances of the games that they owned, and formed a close affinity with them. But when we, as adults, with less time, more money, and a wealth of content vying for our attention, go back to experience the games we missed, I think there's at least the possibility that we dismiss them based on first impressions. Or maybe it's just me. I never grew up with these games, and like I say, NiGHTS, Gunstar, and even Classic Sonic took a while to click with me. And nowadays, I think I was doing those games a huge disservice. You see, NiGHTS may have been soundly thrashed by Mario 64. And you know what, yeah, I can see why. Mario 64 deserves its acclaim. But if you were to ask me which game I would rather play right now, I think there's a bloody good chance I would answer NiGHTS into Dreams.